1 Peter chapter 1, beginning at verse 1, reading to verse 3. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, a grace to you and peace be multiplied. I'll stop there at verse 2 and move into my introduction. So let me give you the basics and then I'll move into the study. This letter of 1 Peter is written to believers who are enduring intense persecution. That's what would be seen. And so for this reason, the Apostle Peter has written to them a letter that is intended to encourage them. It was written around the years 64-65 AD. So by that time, the gospel has already spread from Jerusalem and has gone through a great portion of that place in the world. So it's about 64-65, the gospel is moving out. If you were to say there was a key word, it would be suffering, because this epistle deals with a proper response to persecution. If there's a key chapter, it would be chapter 4, which provides teaching concerning how to handle the persecution. Because believers are suffering through persecution, as mentioned, Peter has written to encourage them. Now, persecution for being identified with Jesus and living a righteous life is inevitable. And the thing to remember is that believers are persecuted because they love the Lord. In John chapter 15, at verse 20, Jesus said, "Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you." And so this letter is intended to bring encouragement to people who are suffering. It was written around 64, 65. The gospel is spreading. Persecution is also spreading. Suffering is something they need to deal with. And so we'll see how he points to us, how we can handle that by the time we get to chapter 4. So with that said, he begins in verse 1, "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, Chino, Ontario, and some parts of Pomona." Now, letters during this day pretty much in general start the same way. They begin with the writer, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. They then speak to the recipients, which he says to the pilgrims of the dispersion. And then they conclude with a blessing, "Grace to you and peace be multiplied." And so when he's beginning here, he says he's writing as an apostle. Notice in verse 1, to the pilgrims. Now the pilgrims he's speaking of who live in the dispersion, also called the diaspora. Now he gives the location, Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. All of these, if you were looking at a map, are in ancient Turkey. So that's who he's writing to. The pilgrims, he says, of the dispersion. Now, James, when he wrote his letter, used the same word to speak of the Jews who do not live in Israel. In James chapter 1, verse 1, it started like this: "James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings." And so at this time, let me give you some background. At this time, around 1 million people lived in Israel, but 4 million Jews were scattered. The city of Rome had been burned. The Romans had been devastated. Everything had been destroyed, including their religious temples, shrines, and household idols. This had shaken them because it had been made obvious that their gods could not protect them, but also were victims of something they couldn't control. So their anger was intensified when they began to believe that Nero had burned the city in order to satisfy his insane lust to build. Nero circulated the rumor that it was the Christians who had set the fire. The Romans already opposed Christians because they associated with Jews and because they opposed Roman culture. So as a result, vicious persecution broke out against the believers and spread throughout the Roman Empire. So the regions, as mentioned in the introduction, are representing modern northern Turkey. And so when he begins here in verse 1 and says to the pilgrims, Peter's using a term that is normally reserved for the Jews, but has been transferred to speak of the church. He's speaking of pilgrims. Now, what is a pilgrim? A pilgrim is a person who comes from a foreign country into a land that is not his own to reside. It speaks of sojourning in a strange place as a foreigner. In the New Testament, heaven is our native country, and we as pilgrims are temporary residents. We are a community living outside of our native land. Our native land is heaven, and we're living outside of our native land temporarily. The earth is not our home. When I first got saved, this is an old saying now, but it was kind of cool then. We used to say, we're just passing through. And that's what pilgrims do. They're just passing through. We're not getting attached to this world. You know, we don't need the things of this world. Why? Because heaven is our home, and earth is just a temporary residence for us. That's what we need to get that back in our heart today, by the way. Because a lot of Christians have become so earthly minded. Everything just revolves around what they have, what they do, where they live. And in fact, we're just passing through. Philippians 3:20 says, our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he's writing to pilgrims, and that would be those of that day, but it speaks to us also. And he refers to him in verse 2 as being the elect according to the foreknowledge of God. So we are chosen. We're chosen by God to be his own special people. And this is the God who wants all men to be saved. We need to remember that. Remember, God loved the world. He loved it so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God so loved the world. God desires the world to be saved. God wants all men to come to him. Isaiah 46:10 says it like this. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say my purpose will stand. I will do all that I please. And so these people know that God wants them to be taken care of in the midst of their persecution. God is working with them. He's doing what he pleases. But his desire is to reach people. And he's speaking to those who are pilgrims who are just passing through. They're undergoing persecution. They need to remember it's not going to always be that way. That we're going to pass through this and we're going to see him face to face. That gives us a special hope. He says in verse 2, in sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus. In sanctification of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit applies redemption to believers. The Holy Spirit works within us and purifies us and sets us apart that we might serve God. So the sanctification of the Holy Spirit empowers and is working to set us apart, but it's the blood of Christ that cleanses us. In 1 John 1:7, remember that scripture. It says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. From some sin? No. From certain sins? No. From all sin. If there's anything that I needed to know, it was that he cleansed me from all sin. Every single stinking sin, everyone, has been forgiven by Jesus Christ. And I tell you, if you walk away with anything tonight, walk away with that. Because there's an awful lot of Christians who wrestle with what they've done in the past. Listen, if you came to faith in Christ and you're washed and you're made new, all things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. You're new in Jesus Christ. The devil loves to remind you what you've done. Again, let me give you an old saying. When the devil comes knocking, reminding you of your past, remind him of his future. You know, somebody once said, when the devil comes knocking to your heart, ask Jesus to answer the door. You know, so we need to rest our hope on the things that Christ has done. And so Jesus is the perfect sacrifice. He's making that clear. For obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, Jesus made the perfect sacrifice for our sins. You see, in the Old Testament, the sacrificial system was built on the shedding of blood. In the Old Testament book of Leviticus, chapter 17, verse 11, the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement by the life. Jesus became the perfect sacrifice. He poured out his blood. John the Baptist sees him and says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Jesus is that true Passover lamb, and Jesus covered us by his blood. And it's a one-time for all-time sacrifice. In Hebrews 9, 13 and 14, the blood of bulls, rather goats and bulls, and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God? If the blood covered the outside, it's Jesus's blood that covers our inside. And that's how we became brand new. He doesn't just clean up an old life. He gives us a completely new one. Mark that in your heart. You're not refurbished. You're reborn. You're brand new. Again, old things have passed away. We've been set apart. We've been freed from sin. And we have the ability to obey. In Romans 6:22, it says, "But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life." So when someone says, "I can't help myself," well, that's not true. Maybe in the flesh you can't, but I can do those things, all things, through Christ who strengthens me. And the Holy Spirit who dwells within me gives me the ability to do that which he commands me to do. We've been set free, and we have to live as those who have. We have to be careful not to run back to that vomit, run back to that mud, the mud we were cleansed from and the vomit that dogs like to return to. We have to see our old life as mud and vomit. Who wants to go back to that? We have to be aware of that. Vomit's gross. I've shared this with you. Why do I think of these things when I teach? I shouldn't. My friend Bill and I, 16 years old, it's Washington's birthday. We go to a liquor store in Norwalk called Wong's Market. It was on Front Street. If there's anybody listening from that area, you'll remember that. Wong's Market. And we went into the Wong Market at the Wong time because we went in and took wine. We were 16 years old, got very, very drunk. We stole a lot, got very drunk. We weren't drinkers, we were just kids at that time. We got arrested, put in the Norwalk substation jail. I was laying on the ground. I was so drunk I couldn't even stand up. My friend Bill, on the other hand, he was sitting down over me. And I've told you this before, as I was laying on my back, his face was over mine. I was there, he was here, and he was sick. All over me. And I'd say, he was vomiting all over my face. And one of the sheriffs came and said, "You guys got to see this." And I couldn't move. So the sheriffs are all there watching my friend as he's puking on me. And I said, "Stop it. Stop it." And he goes, "I can't." I'll never forget that. So who wants to go back to that? You know, we talk about the good old days. What's so good about those old days? Right? When the enemy tries to draw you back, remember what God saved you from. Remember where you were, what you were doing, what your life was like. It was rancid. It was bad. You were lost. You were broken. You were hurt. And Christ picked you up and changed you. We ought to rejoice in things like that. And that's why Peter says, "Grace and peace be multiplied." May God continue to move in you and to show you how good he is. Blessed, verse 3, be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to his abundant mercy, has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed speaks of God being entitled to receive all blessings and praise. May we bless him. Like it says in Psalm 41:13, blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting and to everlasting. Amen and amen. God is entitled to receive our praise. He is worthy of all our praise. He is the God. He's the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. The God and Father speaks of the special relationship God the Father has with God the Son. This is an expression that Paul used in 2 Corinthians 1:3 when he says, "Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, God of all comfort." So in the Trinity, there's Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God is identified as the Father of the Son, Jesus. It also personalizes our relationship with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, verse 3, according to his abundant mercy, has begotten us again to a living hope. Born again, he's begotten us again to a living hope. Jesus' resurrection provides hope for us. If Jesus would have died and remained in the grave, we would not have the hope we have now. But the Bible makes it very clear that because he was raised from the dead, he will also raise us, which gives us hope. In Romans 8, verse 11, Paul said, "If the Spirit of him who raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he who raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken or make alive your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you." So according to his abundant mercy, that's what God used, if you will, that he exercised when we were born again. So what were we born again to? Verse 4, to an inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. To an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that does not fade away. This harkens back to the Old Testament patriarch, a man by the name of Abraham. And God gave an inheritance to this man, Abraham. He gave to him land. In the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, the Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, your father's household, go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great. You will be a blessing." God gave Abraham Israel. We need to keep that in mind in these latter days when there's such argument concerning that. God had given to him the inheritance. The inheritance, all the way in Genesis 12, is the land. We have an inheritance. Our inheritance is fellowship in heaven with Jesus Christ. In Matthew 25, 34, it says, "The king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world.'" In Colossians, Paul said, in chapter 1, verse 5, "The faith and love that spring from the hope that is stored up for you in heaven and that you have already heard about in the world, in the word of the truth, the gospel. This is stored up for us," he says, "in heaven." So heaven for believers is a sure thing, as real as the land that Abraham was to inherit. In Hebrews 11, verses 8 through 10, "By faith Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is God." One of these days, and it won't be long, and it's not that long, we're going to be with the Lord in that place called heaven. What's it like? I don't know. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them. He has disclosed them to us to a certain degree, but we have yet to experience them. But I do know this, that when You read the word and the word gives you promises. Hold fast to them because it's a sure promise. God doesn't lie. And he has promised us that through Jesus Christ, there's a better place. And it's not for just anybody just to go in. As a matter of fact, it's available to anybody. All you need to do is receive the Lord Jesus Christ to do that. But you don't just enter in on your own good works or the things that you do that you think are going to help you to enter in. You have to enter in by faith. And when you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, that inheritance that is prepared for those who love him, that inheritance becomes yours. And so he speaks of it in this way. He speaks of an inheritance. Notice it's incorruptible. When he says it's incorruptible, unlike the things of this age, it doesn't decay. It's permanent. In Matthew 6:20, Jesus said, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. Store up for yourself things in heaven. By way of application, not necessarily absolute correct interpretation, but one of the things that I have grown to kind of think could possibly be true is this. When he speaks of treasures in heaven, sometimes we may think only in terms of just what we would today regard as heavens, but treasures rather. And one of the things that I've come to more and more wonder if it may be true, that it's, we're not storing up just material blessings of any sort, but there are other things in heaven awaiting us, and I look forward to seeing that would be like treasures and like relationships, like the opportunity for me, because there are treasures in heaven. You know, like seeing my dad again, seeing my mom again, seeing my friends again. We've a lot of us in this room have seen many go home, especially with the COVID and things. You know, our fellowship was hit very hard. Some of you know this, some of you may not. But within in the first year and a half or so of when COVID hit, we had between 80 and 90 of our members who succumbed to it and went home through COVID. We had quite a number of people in our fellowship who died. Quite a number of funerals. Now, we already have a number of funerals per year, but this was even more. And so many of us have friends and relatives who are awaiting us. And so part of the joy that we're going to have in heaven is the family reunion, where we're going to be able to get together with those whom we love and miss. And to me, that's a wonderful thing to consider. And so you store up for yourself treasures in heaven. He speaks of it as being undefiled. It doesn't fade away, and it's reserved. In other words, undefiled, it's spotless. It doesn't fade away. It doesn't wither. Reserve speaks of it being guarded. What are you saying? Well, heaven is the most secure place in the universe. Nothing evil can ever enter in. In Revelation 21:27, there shall by no means enter it anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. In Revelation 22:14 and 15, blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexually immoral, murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices a lie, falsehood. Heaven is the most secure place in the universe. Now notice verse 5, he speaks of being kept by the power of God through faith for salvation. Believers are kept by the power of God through faith. When he says who are kept, that word kept speaks of being protected by a military guard. We who are the heirs of heaven are protected by the power of God. Now remember, there's persecution that's occurring that Peter is writing about. And so he's saying, you are under attack, but we're not defeated. In 2 Corinthians 4, 8 and 9, we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. You're in a war. Listen, when you got saved, I'll be sharing some of this on Sunday. When you got saved, you became part of the Lord's army or Marines or Navy or Air Force, or if you're Pentecostal, Air Force for sure. So you're part of the military force of the Lord. And there are no COs. There are no conscientious objectors. You can't pretend that you are injured or can't be part of the battle. No, you're part of it. And that's the thing that some of us didn't realize. You got saved, and man, oh, for me, I got saved. I'm rejoicing. Oh, praise the Lord. And then here comes the attacks of the enemy. And I thought, what's going on here? I thought once you got saved, it's every day's a happy day. You know, just always rejoices, always praising the Lord. What are these attacks? Where are they coming from? Well, I had to be taught, don't you understand you're in the Lord's army? Don't you understand there's a constant warfare? See, before you were on the enemy's side, he didn't have to worry about you. He just needs to give you a little trinket here and there just to keep you satisfied. Like children who have small objects, shiny objects that you give to your one-year-old or two-year-old, and they're there for hours just playing with it. And that's what we were like. The enemy would give us things, occupy our minds, so we're just occupied with this dope, and we're occupied with this relationship, and we're occupied with that alcohol. We're occupied with whatever small thing that kept you going. And then you got saved. And the enemy didn't like that. It sounds almost like a myth. When I was presenting my study today, I thought, boy, this could sound like a children's story, what actually is. I was miserable without Christ. I gave my heart to Christ. I had the joy of the Lord. The enemy didn't enjoy me having the joy of the Lord. So he began to attack the things that gave me joy, tried to undermine my walk so I could go back to being miserable. And it took me a little while to realize that he was actually after somebody as insignificant as me. You may think you're nothing. You say within yourself, I'm not, you know, a servant of any sort. I don't lead worship. I'm not a pastor. I don't teach. I'm not a leader in home fellowship. That doesn't matter. Don't you understand? You're a Christian. You're a believer. You're an enemy. And the enemy wants to take that joy from you. Because there's very few things that are as unattractive as an angry Christian, a mean Christian. There are very few things as unattractive as somebody who is just always miserable. And the enemy wants to keep you miserable. Because even though he can't take you from the Lord, he certainly can make you ineffective. And so I've been doing this for a long time, keeping my mind on that which matters, kept by the power of God. I'm kept by him. Now, what power is greater than the power of God? This power of God is provided on behalf of a believer by faith. To believe, it's been said, is our work. The exertion of power is of God. It's like Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And so faith in God places us in the position to experience the keeping power of God. And God's keeping power brings us to his goal, and that's what he's referring to in verse 5. He says, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Final salvation is his goal. So God is pictured as a soldier escorting people through hostile territory, and he's bringing them to safety and freedom behind friendly lines. So we're kept, verse 5, through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Ready or prepared to be revealed, he's saying. The inheritance is prepared for us, but the glories are yet to be fully revealed. So in verse 5, the last time, until your life has gone its entire route. That would be the day of judgment, the glorification of our body and soul in heaven. And so what are we to do? Verse 6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. If need be, you have been grieved, you've been vexed. Though being tested, God is in control. And God can use suffering to result in the benefit of the ones he loves as a vehicle for him to receive final glory. Now, we're going to be going through this letter and we're going to see various trials. Let me develop this for a moment with you. We're going to be seeing physical persecution, verbal assault. There are things that happen like gossip, economic pressure, spiritual heaviness, marital struggles, child-related problems, sickness, parental pressures, job pressure, neighbors, and in-laws. All of this is going to be dealt with, and we're going to be looking at all of these things, and that's why I wanted to take us through this. There's so many things that we're going through now. But what is the purpose of this? Notice he says again, they're enduring various trials. They can be grieved or distressed. They can get bummed out by these things. Why are we going through these things? Well, verse 7, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it's tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. When I perform weddings on occasion, not everybody's using gold rings anymore. That's kind of interesting. The old, I used the illustration of gold a long time ago, and now people are coming with different kinds of things, and I'm saying, you know, oh man, you're ruining my illustration. So I'll, but I'll share with the couple that's about to be married. I'd say, listen, and said, today you're making promises that are easy to say you'll fulfill. Let's just pray that later on, when they're not so easy to fulfill, that you'll remain true to your promises. And I'll ask them to give me the ring. Sometimes they give me cigar bands and various cheap things, but I'll ask them, give me the rings. And I'll hold it and I'll say, this ring is made out of gold. And gold is refined through fire. And what happens is it's melted and the dross, the things that are imperfect will rise to the top. And the goldsmith will skim it off. And the goldsmith knows that the gold is pure when he can look into the gold and see his own face reflected back at himself. That's when it's pure, when the goldsmith sees himself in the gold. And I'll tell the people that's the purpose of trials. Through the fiery trials, causes the dross, it causes the impurities to rise. And then the Lord scoops them off as we confess and forsake. He scoops them off, if you will. But the ultimate goal is for him to be seen in us. And that's what these impurities, that's how they're removed. When we begin to get upset at God for the trials we go through, sometimes we're going through them because we brought them upon ourselves, because we've made choices that we shouldn't have made, and we're reaping the consequences of bad decisions. And then we blame God. Why are you doing this to me? Other times, there are things within us that God is answering our prayer, so that they would be removed. When we say, God, make me like you, he says, okay. And we go into the cauldron, and we're uncomfortable, and it hurts. And anybody who's been with the Lord knows this, that it doesn't feel good when these things are removed. It's not like you giggle all your way to heaven. It's difficult sometimes. And we can go through these things, these various trials that cause a lot of pain and all of that. And so what he's saying is just hold fast and understand God is keeping you through faith for salvation, but you're being grieved by various trials. Why? That the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it's tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. He's removing the things that are killing you. As a little boy once, and I was in a room. My mom was there, and there's a guy. I didn't know him. But he stabbed me in the stomach in front of my mom. My mom didn't do anything. I'll never forget that. He stabbed me. And my mom didn't do anything. Because he was a doctor. Gotcha. And he was removing my appendix. If he had not removed the appendix, I would have died. Sometimes you go through painful surgeries to remove the thing that's killing you. And instead of me saying, don't touch me, don't hurt me, don't put me through this, I had to lay on that table quietly. Because if I moved when the surgeon was operating, it could damage me. When the Holy Spirit is operating on you, lay still. Don't be jumping off that table. You see, they gave me this whatever. It knocked me out. I still remember him saying, we're going to count from 100 down. I got to about 93 and I was out. I still remember that. But I also remember waking up during the surgery. I also remember hearing him say to the nurse, scalpel. And I still remember seeing him plunge it into my side and slice my stomach open. I went right to sleep when I saw that. The smartest thing I could do was remain still while the surgeon operates. And when the Holy Spirit is removing something from you, stop fighting him. Stop arguing with him. Stop saying, it's good. I need this. It's, you know, she's good to me. You know she's good to me. When in fact, that person you want so bad is destroying your life. Oh, I need this. No, you don't. What you need is the Lord. You need to learn to trust in him, right? And so we have to be very careful that we understand the purpose of trials. It is reducing, it's taking from us the things that keep us from the Lord. It's making us more like him, and he's purifying our faith because testing is going to produce a seasoned, real faith. So when you endure trials, it's intended to produce praise, honor, and glory to the Lord. Psalm 66, verse 10, for you, O God, have tested us. You have refined us like silver. Proverbs 17, 3, the refining pot is for silver, the furnace for gold, but the Lord tries the hearts. So trials have a purpose. They reveal, first, what is really in us. They reveal that. In the midst of the trial, you're going to be revealed for what you really believe. In Jeremiah 12, verse 3, we read, you, O Lord, know me. You have seen me. You have tested my heart toward you. Spurgeon once said, trials teach us what we are. They dig up the soil and let us see what we're made of. So trials have a purpose. They reveal what is in us. And second, they strengthen us. They teach us to wait on the Lord with faith and hope. Like James 1, 2 through 4 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So they strengthen us. And third, they teach us something of the character of God. You're going through the trial and you begin to say, will I ever come out? And what's the purpose of this? Well, again, in James chapter 5, verse 11, we count them blessed to endure. You have heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end intended by the Lord, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. I've had people ask me this question. Some of you perhaps have heard it asked of you. As you grow older in the things of the Lord and all, I've had people say to me, is there anything that in your past you would change? Anything. And at first I had a whole list of things. Of course. You know what I've done now in my latter years? I've said, no, I wouldn't change a thing. Why not? Because it's the things I endured, the things I went through that made me who I am today. They're the things that helped me to see God's grace in so many levels, in so many ways. Would I change them? No. Did I want to go through them? No. Did he put me through them? Did he make me want to sin and do all the sin? No. God doesn't use temptation to sin never does. But God can redeem us through those things we go through and make us into the people we want to be. And I've a long time ago began to say, Lord, make me like you. I want to be more like you. Trials have a way of doing that. They remove the things that are unlike Christ, and they transform you into things, in ways that can bring praise to him. Notice he says your faith will be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus. Your faith will be found to praise. And it says to praise, that refers to the approval that we believers will receive. Praise from the judge himself. We're going to receive commendation. The word praise means approval or commendation. Why? Because our faith is real. In Matthew 25, verse 21, Jesus said that this one's Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. So we receive a well done. Two, honor. Now, honor refers to the honor that God gives to his children in the kingdom. In John 12, 26, if any man serve me, let him follow me. Where I am, there shall my servant be. And if any man serves me, him will my Father honor. And then glory. Glory refers to our participation in the future life. It's filled with radiance. Romans 8, 18, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that will be revealed in us. And this all occurs at the revelation of Jesus or the second coming. And so he's speaking of Jesus, and he says in verse 8, whom having not seen you love, though now you do not see him, yet believing you rejoice with joy inexpressible, full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls, whom having not seen, you love. These are second generation believers, at least second generation. They weren't necessarily those who walked with Jesus when Jesus ministered on planet Earth. What they have heard is the gospel, and they have received the words of the gospel as truth from God. And they love him. They have yet to see him physically with their eyes, but one day they're going to. In the Old Testament book of Job, 19, verse 27, Job said, speaking of God, I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another, how my heart yearns within me. I will see him one day. They never physically saw Jesus, but they loved him, even as we do. They relied on the promises, even as we have. In John 20, 26, following, it says, these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life through his name. You heard the gospel. I heard the gospel. I've never seen Jesus walking on the face of the earth. I never had a conversation with him. I didn't walk with him as the 12 apostles. That was 2,000 years ago. Never seen him, but I do love him. Why? Because I believe his word. Because I believe his promises, just like these people did. You are the same as I in this. It's written that we may believe. It points to us a perfect Savior who loves us. It points us to a cross that he died on, to a tomb he was buried in. It points us to the message of the gospel, sins forgiven, new life promised through him. And what is the result? Joy. Inexpressible and full of glory. The joy that we have when we grasp the reality of our salvation. And that's beyond words. When I first got saved, I still remember very well. I was taught something. I'd never heard this before. Some of you perhaps heard it before you were saved. I never heard of something called a rapture. Never heard of that. What are you talking about? And my friends introduced me to the fact that Christ is coming for us. It's going to take us. We're going to be with him one day. And me, you know, I was going, well, I still remember going, oh, that's wow, really? Yeah, one of these. And I was like, I'm 20 years old. I'm an ex-hippie. I was into hallucinogens and things. So I thought, oh, that was going to be so heavy. You know, I was. It was real. I mean, the fact that Christ is returning and he's taken us was real. And I've told you this before. Some of you haven't heard this. Forgive me for repeating myself. Some of you have heard me say this more than once. But this is what kind of helped me to center on that, was when my friend George and I were driving and I got to a stop sign, took a left turn. George had his Bible in his left hand. I'll always remember that. And as I took the left turn, the passenger side door had swung open and George had leaned out like this with his Bible in his hand. And I hit the brakes. I still remember hitting the brakes and, what are you doing? And I pulled, what are you doing? I thought he was going to jump. I mean, I had no idea what he was doing. And that's when he said, I thought the rapture happened. And true story, I thought the rapture happened. Jesus is a gentleman. He opened my door to let me out. I'll never forget that. And he had his Bible in his hand. So he had his Bible up in the air as his body was like, it's embedded in me that his door was open and mine wasn't. So it made me, what have I done wrong, Lord? But see, that's how real our faith was. That's how real it was. If God said it, he can do it. Why would I argue with God? If God said it, he can do it. I learned that as a brand new Christian. Now, I had to learn certain limits, you know. If he said it, he can do it. What if he didn't say it? Well, he's not going to do it. I had to learn certain things. But that was embedded in me. And it gives you joy. It's what drove me to tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's what I've been doing now all these years. Why? Because it gives you joy. Because these people's sins can be forgiven. The name can be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. They can have a new life. And go to heaven. Are you kidding me? Why not tell people about that? And it brings you such joy. In 2 Corinthians 9:15, it says, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. Believers have this tremendous, inexpressible joy at the reality of our salvation. He says, verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. When he says the end of your faith, it's the goal of our faith. The goal of our faith is salvation. It's a salvation that we presently have, but it's also salvation that looks to the future. And this anticipation and promise to be with Jesus forever is what causes great joy. I was speaking to a dear friend of mine today, Karen Johnson, whose husband Jeff went home to be with Jesus recently. And she asked me to call her. She sent me a text and said, could you call? So I called her and was visiting with her today. And she was talking to me about how heaven has become even more attractive to her. Because she's going to be able to be with her husband once again. They were married over 50 plus years. And she knew him in when she was 13 and he was 15. I mean, you're talking about 60 years. And she was just talking about that, about seeing him again, about that glad reunion that's going to happen one of these days. And it gives you joy. It gives you joy. When you're young, you don't realize. And that's okay. How could you? How could I? You don't realize what your future holds for you in terms of the day-to-day things you go through. As you grow a little older, you begin to experience things that kind of make you wonder in terms of like, gosh, I never expected that, to lose this friend, to lose that friend, to bury my dad, to bury my mom, to eulogize people I've known for so many years. And every time you say goodbye, a little portion of your heart is taken away. Every time. Until one day, when you go to be with the Lord, the joy that you have prepared your heart to experience is fully experienced. And it's the joy of the Lord that is my strength. It's the joy of the Lord and the hope I have in God that has helped me to endure all the things that I have endured as a man for all these years. And there are a lot of joys and there are a lot of pains, a lot of disappointments and a lot of things that you wouldn't have planned for yourself that you experience. But all that does is deepen you as a person and awaken you to a greater longing for that time when you'll see him face to face. And I'm kind of getting it when it says he will wipe away all our tears. Because there are no sorrows in heaven. There are no funerals in heaven. There are no losses in heaven. There's no more pain in heaven. No more sickness in heaven. No more disappointment in heaven. No more funerals. They're all done, man. It's all gone. It's all over. And all there is joy. The psalmist said, you'll show me the path of life in your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Well done, my good, my faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. And not a single tear ever again. Not another painful memory. Not another loss. A glad reunion. And even though you go through hard times and hurts and trials, it's all worth it. Because you're refined. You're made ready for heaven. And then you enter in. And you enter into a joy inexpressible. And Peter wants these people to know that though you're going through a trial that is a fiery one, it's a difficult one, it refines you and prepares you. And one of these days, you'll experience the joy that is beyond any pain you've ever experienced. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so blessed to serve a God like that, like I do. That is what